Good morning to each and all. Welcome to the Ambassador Assembly Discipleship class. As always, both our honor and pleasure to have you both who's here and present, who's present here, as well as our online audience. Peace and blessings to you. I trust that everyone had a good week. As we know, I like to say, us having a good week has nothing to do with the physical, but how we perceive it. Amen. The Bible says that we walk by faith and not by sight. Amen. Today we'll be coming out of Psalms 51, or better yet, we're going to start in Psalms 51. We will not be visiting this verse again. I just want to open up with this verse, and we're going to read it in its entirety. Amen. You have it, say amen. Psalms 51. Amen. And it reads, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sins is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight, that you may be found just when you speak and blameless when you judge. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in my sin my mother conceived me. Behold, you desire truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part you will make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me hear joy and gladness, that the bones you have broken may rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all of my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore me to the joy of your salvation, and uphold me by your generous spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your way, and sinners shall be converted to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God, the God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of you, of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall show forth your praise. For you do not desire sacrifice, or else I would give it to you. You do not delight in burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. Do good in your good pleasure to Zion. Build the walls of Jerusalem. Then you shall be pleased with the sacrifices of righteousness, with burnt offering and whole burnt offering. Then they shall offer bulls on your altar." Amen. I want to teach briefly today, using as a subject title, prayer and repentance. Amen. And this is going to wrap up our series entitled, "Woe is Me." Amen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, first and foremost, we just like to extol your name, Father. We just like to give you all the praise, glory, and honor just for who you are this morning. Father, you're so good. You're so merciful. You're so graceful, Father. Only you are holy, and we thank you for waking each and one of us up this morning and starting us on our day. Father God, we thank you for being a provider, Father. We thank you for being a waymaker, Father. We thank you, Lord God, for leading us into this building this day so that we may learn of you, so that we may grow closer to you in your word and by your word. And Father God, right now, decrease so that you can increase in me. Father, I pray that you have prepared the ears and the hearts of those who will be receiving this message, that they may grow in wisdom and the knowledge of your word. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. I like the book of Psalms. It's evident, but for those who don't know, Psalms is the largest book in the Bible. It's the largest book in the Bible. And it mainly consists of prayer and praise and worship. Prayer, praise, and worship. Right, and repentance. We see over and over again where David is asking for repentance, or he's praying to God, or he's praising God. And I think all of those things are intertwined into each other. But I think it highlights the importance of both, right? And really what I want to teach on today, prayer and repentance. And as I just stated, this will wrap up our series entitled Woe Is Me. Amen. Woe being wretchedness. We must understand that even when we enter into the kingdom of God, we are still wretched. It's just the blood of Jesus Christ is covering us in our wretchedness. But we must not forget our wretchedness. And that's what keeps us humble. Amen. Not only before God, but also before men. Amen. So I want to wrap this up today with prayer and repentance. Amen. So prayer and repentance are closely related in Scripture. The two can often be regarded in the same light, seeing that repentance comes only by prayer and that prayer is an ongoing act of repentance, both being a remedy of the fallen nature, they act in one accord. And by me saying both are a remedy of the fallen nature, when all was well, we didn't have to repent. Amen. And by the law first mentioned, the first prayer came after sin. Amen. So what prayer is just a petition to God for God to hear our cries. Amen. So when one repents, he takes a humble path to the throne of God, seeking undeserved mercy and kindness by way of prayer. Amen. And in like manner, the nature of prayer suggests that one is incapable, or more so aware of their inability to do for themselves what only God can do. Amen. So they humbly ask of God, which is still to seek undeserved mercy, kindness, and favor. Nevertheless, because of our fallen state, we are forever indebted to them both, as being our primary way to make peace with God and to ensure that God in his mercy and grace returns the gesture. Mm-hmm. Seeing that every good act of God mostly ensued through prayer and repentance, this is the way of the believer. Amen. Even being commanded in Scripture by God to his people to pray continuously and fervently. Because of our fallen state, this is our way. Amen. God has commanded us in Scripture to pray and repent. Amen. 1 Thessalonians 5:17, it says, pray without ceasing. Right? This is a continuous prayer, right? This is a continuous state of petitioning God and supplications. Amen. James 5:16, it says, confess your transgressions one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. Mm-hmm. The effective fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Amen. The word fervent means passionate. Mm-hmm. Amen. So God wants us to be passionate in our prayer life. Mm-hmm. Amen. Given that that's our only way to really enter into his presence. Amen. Which is through passionate prayer. Amen. Mm-hmm. Pure, from a pure heart. Amen. Prayer from a pure heart that's passionate. Amen. Philippians 4:6, it says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything. Somebody say everything. But in everything, by prayer and supplication With thanksgiving, let your request be known to God. This is one of my favorite verses, amen, because it teaches us how to approach God in prayer, amen. We can't, it says, but in everything, by prayer and supplications, with prayer and supplications basically means the same thing, but I believe supplications is a deeper, more intimate way to pray to God, but he combined them both. We should pray, by prayer and supplications, amen. So prayer should be our moment or our way to get intimate with God, amen, or to grow intimate with God, amen, but with thanksgiving, amen. In the youth department, my youth, we're studying prayer, right, and I'm teaching them about prayer, and this is one of the scriptures that we're dealing with because, it teaches us how to approach God, because in everything, the Bible also says to be what? Thankful, right? So when I'm thankful first, you got to be thankful first and foremost as you approach God with the mindset that even if God does not answer my prayer request, I'm good because I understand that he is in fact a good God. And that up until this point, even if he don't do anything else for me, he has done enough. Amen. Can anybody testify to that? That God has done enough for me. Even though he's given us access to him through prayer, he's told us to present our prayer request to him. We must be thankful enough and have enough gratitude in our heart to the point to where we won't murmur after our prayer request if it's not answered, right? Or we may not, or we won't be too anxious in the process or in the moment of process as we await an answer from God. Amen. We'll be content in our hearts. Amen. Knowing that God is good. Amen. And whatever answer or verdict that God's come with concerning our prayer request, we good with that. Amen. Because God has done enough. Amen. Luke 18:1. And I'm just, giving you scriptures about prayer. God has commanded us to pray. Amen. Luke 18:1, men ought always pray and faint not. Faint not means to lose heart. Amen. So we're to always pray and not lose heart. And if you're losing heart, that speaks to doubt. Amen. We have to build up our faith in the word so that when we pray, amen, we're praying from faithfulness and that we're trusting God about our prayer requests. Amen. 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, that's how we seek the face of the Lord, through prayer and also through his word. Amen. And turn from their wicked ways, which is to what? When you turn from your wickedness, what are you doing? You're repenting. That's the act of repentance. Repentance isn't just me saying, Lord, I'm sorry. But repentance is me turning from my transgressions. Amen. Then I will hear from heaven. This is Jesus, obviously. If he's hearing from heaven, this is Jesus Christ, which is our intercessor. He stands in the gap between us and God. This is why in our prayers, we end it in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Then I will hear from heaven and will forgive them their sins and heal their land. Amen. I like this verse because it's one of the only verses that puts humility at the forefront of prayer. Amen. He said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. Amen. Prayer is the posture of humility. It's one of the postures of humility because it takes a humble person to understand or know that they need help. Oh, yeah. Amen. To know that they are inadequate in and of themselves. Amen. That they need a redeemer, that they need a savior, that they need a God. Amen. That takes humility to understand that. Amen. This was the problem with the Pharisees and Sadducees or the Jews. Amen. They were so haughty in themselves and puffed up in themselves that they did not know that they needed a savior. This is why Christ said, I did not come for the well, because they themselves thought they were well. Amen. They were not humble, but they were puffed up. They were exalted in themselves. Amen. But prayer takes humility. It comes from a posture of humility to know that, God, I'm inadequate. God, I'm insufficient within myself to do for myself what only you can do. Amen. Hebrews 4:16 says, come boldly before the throne of grace to what? Receive help in our time of need. Amen. It takes humility to come before God. Even with us, how many times we our pride been in the way of us asking for help? We needed help, but we were just too prideful to ask. Amen. It's a saying that say you have not because you ask not. That's even in scripture. You have not because you ask not. But asking comes from a posture of humility. You must humble yourself to be able to ask for something that you don't have or something that you need. Amen. And this coming or approaching God's throne is done in prayer. Amen. This is how we approach God, through prayer and supplications. Amen. The first motivation of God's, the first motivation of God is his will. That's God's first motivation, right? Is his will. His will is what? His plan or his agenda. Somebody say his plan, his agenda. This is his first motivation, right? Now, how he carries it out, this is determined by our ability to pray, which is to revere God. When we pray, we show that we revere God or we respect him. And repent, which is to turn from our evilness, as we just stated. Amen. Prayer is our tribute to God. Amen. And repentance is the proof thereof. Looking at the most famous example of prayer in scripture, we will find that the two are forever inseparable. Prayer and repentance are forever acceptable. Because a person that goes to God and expects to receive something from him must have repented. Because we understand what repentance leads to. Repentance leads to being born again. Repentance leads to us being saved. Repentance leads to salvation. Repentance leads to redemption, to us entering back into sonship. And only then do we have the right to ask of the Father. That's, you know, that's another reason why I say it's inseparable, right? Because to ask God, he only hears the prayers of sons. Amen. So if we're going to God expecting something of God or expecting God to hear our prayers, we must have been born again. Amen. There's even a place in scripture, I don't want to paraphrase, but Jesus Christ was praying and he said that I'm not praying for the world. He said, but I'm praying for those who you've given to me. Amen. Because God will only hear the prayer of the righteous. The Bible said a few verses up, what we just read, the prayer of the righteous availeth much. Amen. So it's only a righteous prayer that God will take ear to. Amen. So prayer is our tribute to God. Amen. And I want to use Matthew chapter 6, starting at verse 9. As an example of how we should pray. I feel like this is the creme de la creme or the best example in scripture of how we should pray. So if you will, you can follow me if you please. Mm-hmm. Matthew 6, starting at verse 9, and we're going to read 9 through 13. Amen. Now, I will state that this is Jesus himself informing the disciples how to pray. So what better example of how to pray than a prayer that Jesus gave himself? Amen. Jesus in fact said in this manner, you should pray. Amen. Not saying this should be the only prayer that we pray, but we should use this prayer as a schematic on how to pray and approach God in prayer. Amen.
So Matthew chapter 6, starting at verse 9. In this manner, or in this way, in this fashion, therefore pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Amen. Prayer is our way of giving tribute to God. Amen. A way to revere and show respect to his great name. That's what hallowed be your name means. We should hallow the name of God. Amen. The Bible says, even when it comes to Jesus Christ, the Bible says he has given him a name that's above every other name. Amen. So prayer is our way of giving tribute to God. Amen. We give tribute to a lot of things. Amen. And we must be careful in that God has no problem with us giving respect or reverence to things in the physical. But we cannot give more reverence to these things than we do to God himself. Amen. God is a great God. Amen. And he's worthy of praise. Amen. We find ourselves praising a lot of things, correct? I like sports. Amen. So you'll hear me a lot talking about Alabama, Roll Tide, Nick Saban, Lakers. But we can't find ourselves. See, there's a thin line between idolatry. Right? I'm telling you, it's a thin line. I'm telling you, we can cross over that line so quickly. Amen. But I always state, I remember, when I first started really committing myself to God and the things of God, I was thinking, matter of fact, I heard a man of God say this, we was in praise and worship, and he was trying to prompt the people to pray. And he said, you know what? If Alabama football was on right now, I wouldn't have to tell you to scream to the top of your lungs, because you would be screaming to the top of your lungs, right? For Alabama football, right? If your favorite team was playing, I wouldn't have to tell you to get excited, because you will already get excited. And that, for one, touched me, because I'm a person that get real excited watching sports. And I thought to myself, how is it that I can get more excited about something carnal than about my God? Amen. So from that day on, I started putting more effort in praise and worship, right? And everybody got their own way to praise and worship. You feel what I'm saying? Everybody ain't got to do it the same way. But you must examine your life. And if you a person that gets riled up or excited about something in your life, then you should get more excited about God. Now, if you're a person that don't really get excited because you don't have to scream or you don't have to shout. I know we get pumped and primed to do this, but this isn't something that you have to do if you don't feel like doing it, if you feel like this ain't you. Some people just be quiet and some people lift their hands. Some people, even the Bible says the Spirit makes intercession for us, right? You know, some people just with gratitude in their heart, they just humble themselves and they just lift their hands without saying anything. But me personally, I felt that since I'm a person that does get excited, it's only right that I get excited for God, right? Or else God will be jealous, right? The Bible says that he is a jealous God. Amen. So we must be careful what we give tribute to, because whether you know it or not, we give tribute to a lot of things in this world. Amen. Well, we set stuff aside, apart. You know what I'm saying? So if this is the case, you must be careful to do that and more for God. Amen. So in this manner, therefore, pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Verse 10, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Prayer also acknowledges our incompetence and inability to do what's good. Amen. So we see that his good will be done. Right? We pray to God that his will be done, not ours. Amen. Because we understand that in and of ourselves, we are incompetent, that we don't have the ability to do what's good. as a Christian, we must understand this. A lot of Christians don't understand this because at some point in their Christian walk, they feel like they have arrived. This is why this series is entitled Woe Is Me. Amen. Some of us need to start over and go back to the beginning. Some of us need to be reorientated in Christianity. Amen. Because I believe a lot of people came into Christianity the wrong way. You know, from more of a religious mindset or a religious posture. Amen. Your kingdom come, not my kingdom. Amen. Your will be done, not my will. On earth as it is in heaven. Amen. So that means that there must be a parallel. And this is what I'm praying in my life. I'm praying that, Lord, I pray that through me, heaven invades earth. Through my talk, heaven invades earth. Through my actions, heaven invades earth. This is the posture of prayer. I should pray that when people see me, that they see God. Amen. Not saying that I am God, but I'm born again of his spirit. And with God's spirit in me, I should display his acts. I should display his characteristics in this earth. Because we do take on the characteristics of God once we're born again. This is why our mind should be renewed. The Bible says you will know them by how they love one another. So you will know them by their fruit. Amen. And fruit means characteristics. You got something to say, Erica?
You don't mean that lady was saying little damn work. She said, you can tell a person about Jesus when they're not. And she said, folks get married, you talk about Jesus, they have like you full stomach.
Amen.
She said, but don't go to all when you get even go through them. We going through or not going through.
There you go.
She said, everybody going on earth for all fast, but they get going on when they want.
There you go.
She said, we need to go every day, not one day.
Right. And his needing should be, this needing, I want to make that more plain. Don't go to God when you need him for something. Because we always are in need of God. But you have those, and us being in need of God is just in need of his presence, right? Just in need of his guidance, right? But this isn't what people pray for. They don't pray for God's guidance. They don't pray for God's wisdom. They pray that God meets a want in their life. I ain't even going to say a need.
A want.
Because it's really a want. They want something. They want God to perform it in their lives. And this is one way where you can really examine a person's heart by what they pray for. Now, your prayer life should be private, but, you know, we come together corporately and we have corporate prayer. But you can determine a person's heart by how they pray and what they pray for. If you're a person that prays for more carnal things, then you are a carnal person and you need to be renewed. I always like to go to Solomon. When God asked Solomon, he said, ask me anything. Anything. This God saying this. That's just like the king. Back in the days, if this prime example, who it was, Vita, Pilate, or Herod, when they asked the little girl, ask me anything, and I'm going to do it for you, because she danced or played the flute real good. Was it who it was, Pilate? I think it was Pilate. Don't quote me on that. But he asked the girl, ask me anything, and I'm going to do it for you. The girl asked for John the Baptist's head. And at the moment, he felt sorrowful that he even asked her that, because he got to give it to her because he gave her his word. The king's word is all that he has. The Bible said, my word shall not return unto me void. So God is asking him that. Now keep in mind that God is a person of infinite wisdom. He knew Solomon's heart before he asked him this question. God wouldn't ask the heathen this. He wouldn't ask somebody who haven't been renewed or trained or fashioned in the things of God. He wouldn't ask them that because he knew they would have said something carnal. All the riches. You know, what you would have said there back in your days before you knew Christ. A Pontiac GTO.
You know.
Right. But we would have asked for something carnal, right? Something outrageous.
Yeah,
stupid.
Stupid.
Right? But here it is. This man said, Lord, give me wisdom. Not even wisdom for myself, but wisdom so that I can do your will, so that I can govern your people fairly. Mm-hmm. Look at that. And this is the type of heart that God wants us to have. Because the Bible specifically tells us, seek ye first the kingdom and its righteousness, and things should be added. Mm-hmm. Things are perishable, but righteousness is forever, is everlasting. So we should seek righteousness. And in this moment, Solomon sought righteousness. The Bible says, he who lacks wisdom as God, who gives unsparingly. Mm-hmm. Amen. Go ahead.
Man, this is so good, because I always tell Bill, I tell Cheryl, I tell, you know, other people, even at work, wants and needs.
Wants and needs.
Wants and needs.
Totally different.
You know, especially young people, even older people. You know, we be wanting, sometimes we really wanting stuff because we see it.
All right.
Tangible stuff.
Come on.
Like I said, it's tangible. But you can't see the spirit.
Can't see it.
You can't see that spirit.
It's Amen.
You have to want
like, eternal things.
Man, look here. Like I said, I can't say what I want. You know, I can.
Yeah.
I'm not.
Right.
That's a total different scenario.
Mm-hmm.
But see, we want so much stuff. We want so much stuff
that we don't need.
We don't need. It isn't worth.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can get all this stuff. But check out one thing, you don't think about when, if you ain't in the right mind, you think about, man, somebody, if you have wow. stuff, somebody else wants stuff.
Right, come on.
If people see you bringing something in,
right.
They're like, how yeah. did you get this?
Yeah, entering into that eye gate.
Mm-hmm. One time, they always be just some, in a little way, some people be a little jealous of each other.
All right. Coveting, right. Covet this babe.
The word.
Amen.
See, it's in that word, man. Find everything.
Right.
Not some things, everything.
Right.
Everything mm-hmm. pertains to life
and godliness. Amen.
It ain't about no, well, I want this, I want this, I want that, I want that. What do you need?
Amen.
Man, we need the word. Man, I need the word every day, man.
Amen.
That's the only thing that keeps me.
Amen.
Because, man, look here. God kept all of us.
Amen.
In the back of the days that when we were doing some stuff that.
When we was in our sin.
We was in ourselves.
Amen.
But he showed up protecting us now.
Amen.
I'm telling Erica and Sheldon, God has angels protecting us.
That's right.
While we sleep, when we all on job, wherever.
Amen.
You know, even, I say, even we do die, I know I got a place waiting for
Come me. Come on, got it, man. Amen.
I need some horrible stuff.
Amen.
But God forgave me, but people won't.
Amen.
See, that's the difference. That's why that agape love is so important.
Amen.
Not no just plain love. Because you can love somebody and say you love somebody. Like I remember back in the day, I used to fool with these women. He said, love. And then he said, love is an action. Prove it to me.
Right.
Prove it to me. If you love me so much, come here and prove it to me.
Show me.
Show me.
Amen.
But see, a lot of times we won't. Man, our eyes so be so big on right. you know. Need something.
But that speaks to our mindset.
Yeah,
the Bible says, the Bible says not to covet.
Oh, man. Yeah, don't cover that shit.
Yeah, not to covet.
I'm telling you, I don't have, lost again, ain't gonna have anybody
that's
nothing.
That's what Solomon said. Solomon, and I believe, so in that, in Solomon asking for wisdom, God said, not only will I give you wisdom, but I'm gonna give you that which you didn't ask for. This is why Solomon was the richest man in history.
Yeah.
He had more wealth, more money than any man could think of,
yeah.
right? And I believe that God granted Solomon this so that in his experience, he could write to us what this stuff really brings. And in the Songs of Solomon, he said, or Ecclesiastes, one of them, he said that it's all vanity.
Yeah.
It's vanity because at the end of the day, when you die, you're giving it to somebody else. Right?
Somebody taking it.
It's all vanity. Amen. The Bible says heaven and earth, heaven shall pass away, but my word shall last forever. It's eternal. And us seeking carnal things is a testament to our mind. Amen. If you have an unrenewed mind, you're going to always ask for carnal things. Notice when people talk about a breakthrough, they really talking about Stuff. Carnal stuff. Stuff. How you gonna break through with stuff? Stuff can't break you through. The Bible says, store not your wealth on earth where rust and moth can decay, meaning it can be destroyed. Amen. But store up your treasures in heaven. How do you store up treasures in heaven? By having the fruits of the Spirit. Amen. By being persistent with the things of God. When our eye gates get us in trouble. This is why we must train our minds. And when we train our minds, our eye gates are changed. Stuff that we like are changed. Now, I say this all the time. Or people say this, you know, that God will take the taste out your mouth. Amen. What he doing is he giving you a different lens to see stuff through. Now you will be a person with less wants. Amen. You will be a person that want less. Contentment is a characteristic of the kingdom. We got a lot of uncontent Christians because they want. And you should question, what do you have? Because if you have Jesus Christ, you got everything. Come on. Just like you said, the Bible says he has given us all things pertaining to life and godliness. So we should equate this in our prayer life, knowing that if I have all things, why am I asking God for things? This is why we must read our word, because we'll see stuff that say, ask me anything. Well, God put that in there, assuming that you read Matthew 6 and 33. Right? If you don't read Matthew 6 and 33, but you read, ask me anything, you would be assuming that God really mean that when he don't. Because the Bible says you have not because you ask not. And you ask with the wrong motives. So it ain't all about you asking because you have not because you ask, but you ask with the wrong heart. So that you can what? Spend it on your own pleasures. Amen. So here Jesus is teaching us how to pray. And prayer comes from the posture of humility, assuming that your mind have been renewed. All of this plays a part in prayer. The prayers of a righteous availment, not the carnal. Amen. So in this manner, therefore, pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. 11, give us this day our daily bread. Amen. Prayer suggests that God is wisdom and that he gives to all men as they ask and seek him. He is infinite wisdom. Give us this day our daily bread. Amen. We should constantly seek God for wisdom. And, you know, I tell my family members all the time, because people got the wrong perception of what Christianity is. Christianity is life. It's life. What you seek. And I ask people, what you want out of life? Oh, I just want to be my best self. Well, God is going to teach you how to be your best self. That's what Christianity is. What you want out of life? Well, you know, I just want to be successful. God is going to teach you how to be successful. It's life. And then once we understand this, that God ain't trying to make you out to be no monk or no nun. He ain't trying to deprive you of life. He's trying to give you life. But we watered down Christianity to make people not want it. They feel like I'm not ready for it because they feel like Christianity takes so much from you. That's a lie. What is taken from you is the stuff that shouldn't be there in the first place. It's stripping you of the things, just like I always like to use the construction business. Someone who's remodeling. God is in the remodeling business, but before you add on new, you must take out the old, or else the old will corrupt the new. The Bible says that you can't put new wine in old wineskins, or it's going to burst. And it's going to waste. The new will be wasted. So yes, in Christianity, God do want to strip you of some things. But the things that he want to strip you of is so that he can add the new in your life. Mm-hmm. Amen. Sometimes Well, I ain't gonna say sometimes. A lot of times when you ask God and he ain't gave it to you yet, it's because you ain't ready to have it. So your prayer requests need to be, God, prepare me for what I'm asking you for. Because he already know your heart. You need a husband, Lord, prepare me for a husband. You need a wife, Lord, prepare me for a wife. You want to be successful, Lord, prepare me for success. How you want to be successful and you in debt? How you want to be successful and you can't steward money? See, we want to just jump. Yeah, we want to skip over the process, yabba dabba do, you know, poof, and have all this stuff. That's not the God I serve. Jesus had to go through a process. Jesus just didn't enter into the world and take on the cross. He had to go through a process. The Bible says that this work that I have begun in you, I shall continue to the day of completion. But we don't like the process. Because in the world is fast. And the kingdom is slow because we got all the time in the world. Amen? Because we operate in eternity. Amen? See, in the world, time against us. So we just racing against the clock, just trying to do every and all the things that come to mind and just make us feel good before we die. I want to have fun before I die. I'm trying to live my life. We ain't here to live our life. We're here to give our lives unto God, to sacrifice our lives for God, for his will. Sacrifice my will for his will. Go ahead, Sister Erica.
You're like, this young lady working with us.
Mm-hmm.
Me and Mom was talking the other day. She said, if you ain't thankful for the pepper meat he gave you, how you going to be thankful for that faith?
Come on.
She said, he ain't going to give you nothing else until you thankful for what you get. She said, it ain't what you live or how you live.
Come on.
She said, for those who complain, they need sacrifice. She said, for those who complain, work off to me.
Come on. God conditions us to where we thrive off the spiritual and not the flesh. In the flesh, we thrive off the fleshly and not the spiritual. He's trying to condition us to, it's the complete opposite, that we thrive off the spirit and not the fleshly. Amen. This is why the Bible say you are indeed spirit and not flesh. Right? Because he's trying to condition us to be more spiritual or be more spiritually driven. Or more spiritually motivated, more spiritually influenced. And when that's the case, the spirit will manifest in itself in your life. Prime example. It's easy to praise God when all things are well. Easy. You'd be the best Christian it is. Know what to say. Know where Bible verse fit what occasion for another person. But yet, when that person finds themselves in a dilemma, where it went, bro? I mean, you were, the other day you were just telling such and such that in this world you will have trouble, but be of good cheer, but yet you find yourself in trouble. But that speaks to an unrenewed mindset. Many people got the word. Many people can quote scriptures. But until you have a new heart, a contrite heart, David said, place in me a contrite heart. It's a new heart, a fleshly heart, a soft heart, a heart that can feel. Until you have that, then the word will profit you nothing. So many people can quote scriptures, but yet they can't show the smallest percent of humility in their life. Yeah, simple things. And this is the purpose of this series. We got to start over. We got to stay low. I just want to stay low. That's why I try to stay away from a lot of things. Because of things will puff you up. Things will get you out of the posture that God intended for you. Pick up your cross and follow me. Right? All of these things in scripture that suggest that we give up what we consider to be life or give up what we consider to be good to follow what God said or to have what God says is truly good. Amen. Go ahead, Brother Derek.
I always tell a lot of people, I don't want to be up so high. See, you have to, like you say, humbleness. You got to be humble. I don't care how high you man will try to exalt you, but man also will tear you down.
Yeah.
But God will lift, when God lifts you up,
come on.
Nobody can tear you down.
Nobody can bring you down.
Nobody. You got to stay home.
Come on.
You got to stay low. You got to love, man. You got to even.
Come on.
Man, if, and I would think, I criticize myself a lot, and I would think, and I have to be home. You got to think that you have to be humble so you can show other people how to be way, certain way.
Amen.
Some people just have let that pride just eat them up and just have them messed up all kinds of ways. Like you said, you can, it's only people know the scripture. The devil knows the scripture.
The devil knows the scripture.
He know more bad than we do.
Come on.
But that mean, you know,
he, all right, come on, he damn the hell.
Man, it
gotta be in your heart.
Yeah, your heart.
And see, that's people, we say knowing, but we in the kingdom have a different perception of knowing. Knowing comes from the heart. Knowing is relational. Have I committed myself to what I think I know? That's the question.
And walking by it.
And walking by it. That's the commitment. And it was a point in my life where I had to make that decision.
Yeah.
And this, I was talking to somebody, I'm going to get to you, sister, here. I was talking to somebody, I can't remember who it was, but, you know, a lot of us grew up in church, right?
Yeah.
But it's at some point in that child's life, whether he's preteen, teenager, or adult, it's some point in that person's life where themselves have to make a verbal and a commitment. Or not just verbal, just a commitment to God themselves. Not, you know, mama ironing your clothes and making sure you prepare for church and she taking you to church. No, at some point in life, you're going to have to make that commitment and decision that I want God. Enough that I do get up and go to church and not just go to church because we don't want to just make it all about that. But just I pursue the things of God in my life. Amen. I take what I learned in church and I apply it in my life. I go to church because the Bible say forsake not the assembly, because I understand that when I go to church, I'm recharging myself. I'm encouraging myself with the things of God. I'm being edified enough so when I go out, I can resemble and reflect Christ. Amen. Go ahead, sister.
I work on FFU on Dawson Street, and we read this big dog to the gas company. White folks than black folks.
Mm-hmm.
White folks. They treat me and my mama with so much respect. Why they say, God don't love you because you're killing. I live a lot with y'all.
That's right.
See that God ain't no respectful person.
That's right.
So nice. And the white guy was that he drove to.
Mm-hmm.
He gave some people who confused on their day on trustful.
Mm-hmm.
I came up on the floor but I was cleaning they off.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the picture man on this, he said, I'm picking. I walked down the path. Well, I knew he had got a bag too. And he said, take one.
All right.
They want some more.
All right. So how can we be that? Do you say God ain't a respective person? We shouldn't either. But the way we get that is through a new heart. Mm-hmm. Right? We get that. We get to that point from a new heart. To where we're no longer judging things from a carnal standpoint by the flesh, whether it's status, you feel what I'm saying? Reputation, right? Man judges things by that, but God doesn't. This is why we must be renewed and prayer. Like I said, we are forever indebted to prayer because this is the way of the Christian, because by prayer, I continue in these things, right? Because we can be here today and be elsewhere tomorrow. By prayer, I continue in the things of God. This is what I'm praying for. Lord, let your ways be in my heart. We see that with David. We see this over and over in Psalms. Lord, teach me your word and teach me how to walk in your word. Help me understand your word, right? Teach me righteousness. Let righteousness be in my heart so that I can continue. It ain't about asking for cars and houses. God, no, you need these things. He said, if I clothe the lilies of the fields and feed the bird in the air, how much so shall I you? He loves us. He said, don't I love you more than them? The birds of the air, I feed them. They don't, the lilies of the field, they don't spin nor toil, but yet I clothe them. Right? How much so shall he us? Amen? Go ahead. Come on. But we just got to get to the place to where our spirit man is stronger than our flesh. Then we don't see this in the church. This is why God put it on my heart. This isn't a popular message. This isn't a popular series. Because this ain't the norm what we used to hear in the church. We used to hear in prosperity, kingdom wealth, all of these things. Get your blessing. Yours, yours, yours. That's not scripture. The Bible says give yours up. The Bible says forsake you.
And give to somebody.
Yeah. Help. Forsake you. Mm-hmm. All the disciples gave all. Mm-hmm. All they had, even their family, and followed Christ. I don't even see where in scripture they even wrote home. Well, they even returned home. Mm-hmm. Even that show you right there. Like, it's like in the world, being a good father or a good husband is a good thing. But yet Christ said, who is my mother? Who is my father? Who is my husband? Who is my wife? Those who do the will of the Father. So there is a separation from what the world deems as good and what the kingdom deems as good. Amen? Go ahead.
I'm going to tell you something. I learned it some couple years ago. If you do what God will, he going to take care of you.
He's going to take care of you.
Anybody you connected to. Anybody.
Mm-hmm.
And see, when you leave somebody, like you said, the society, they love everything. Their job, mm-hmm. their wife, their family, their children.
Like that. In an instant.
Boy, you tell somebody, man, you got to leave.
The rich young ruler.
Wait a minute. The stuff I have. Do you know how much I got? You so sad that he won't give up.
Right.
If he had gave up for God, he would be rich.
Right. The funny thing about that Bible verse is that even though he had all, he understood that he was missing something. Right?
And that's the most important thing he was missing.
He was missing the most important thing. Because he can't take that into heaven. Or he can't bargain with that stuff for his life. Or salvation. He can't get to the door and say, hey, I ain't get salvation, but I got all this money. Let me go on. It don't hold no weight in heaven.
It's
tangible. God gonna say, depart from me, for I never knew you. At that moment, Christ was giving him the opportunity to know him. But knowing Christ comes at a cost. That's the purpose of the message behind the rich young ruler. We all had some prior to knowing Christ. But as Paul stated, I consider all things dung compared to coming into the true knowledge of Christ. So if you ain't willing to give up what you had or what you once valued for Christ, then you will never get him. And this is the evidence that people don't have Christ. It's evident. In what they pursue. Because listen to what he said. He said, compared to coming into the true knowledge of Christ. So at one point in Paul's life, he assumed he had Christ, but he didn't.
He just knew.
He just, yeah, knew of him. He knew of him. He heard of him. And he knew how to do religious things, rituals, stuff that God in the Old Testament said he's tired of it, sick of it. He had enough of it. He said, don't even do it no more. Right? Compared to coming into the true knowledge of Christ. Have you counted the cost to be my disciples? Right? This is true Christianity. Christianity is all about suffering. The Bible tells us that we must suffer as Christ suffered. God ain't trying to just have us just. No, that's backwards. That's contrary to scripture. If that the case, Christ would have came bawling. He ain't come bawling. Every aspect of Jesus' life was low. Every aspect, from the way he was born in a manger. You know what a manger is? Yeah. That's the stables. Yeah. Back in the days of you, I like watching movies. I'm watching, like, you know, the Vikings and things like that, you know. And you know, you ain't finna stay in no, if you were somebody of prestige, you ain't finna stay in no stable. The stable, where they keep the horses at. But yet, that's where Christ was born. He was a carpenter's son. That's like working a common job, right? Every aspect of his life was lowly. That's why I said many men in the Bible lived a better life than Christ. Many of them. This is why the Jews couldn't get with him. They couldn't get with him because he did not fit the perception or the expectations that they had of him. They still waiting on him. Ain't that something? The Jews still waiting on the Messiah because ain't nobody came yet that fit those expectations that they had. They still waiting, and they're going to continue to wait because Christ already came. He said, you pour over the scriptures. He said, you pour over the scriptures looking for eternal life, but you don't have them because the scriptures speak of me, and yet you reject me. Come on. Christianity ain't about saying I'm a Christian. Christianity is about accepting what Christ did. To be a Christian means you are a follower of Christ. Let's just start saying that. I'm a follower of Christ. And as I stated before, following Christ don't mean this. That don't mean that. Following Christ is being an imitator of all that Christ did in the Bible. Why is it that we so focused on doing sign, miracles, and wonders when Christ wasn't? That wasn't his goal. Evident in scriptures, he said, man, listen, don't go tell nobody. He said, keep this between me and you. But yet we want to be on the forefront. How I know? Because we have a healing service. A healing service? Healing ain't going to bring nobody to Christ. A miracle isn't going to save somebody's soul. It might save their arm, but the same arm you saved is still going to go to the grave. Decay. It's still going to decay. Come on. Like, what's wrong with the church? We know what's wrong with the church. They don't know Christ. They don't know Christ because Christ isn't in their heart. They know better than the Jews because what they portray church to be speaks on what they expect. Yeah. Everything we expect is all catered to the flesh. Everything, kingdom wealth, your advancement. Everything speaks to the flesh. Like God is here to please us. No, we are here to please God. And the only way we can please God is through humility. Amen. Let me finish this. So, let me start. In this manner, pray. Therefore, you pray, our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And again, Jesus isn't saying pray this prayer only. He wants us to use this as a schematic, as a blueprint, as an example on how to pray. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, or forgive us our sins as we forgive others of their sins. And as the title of this message entails, there's no prayer without repentance. For all prayer points towards repentance. And on another note, even in the Bible, if the Bible says if you don't forgive men of their sins, God in heaven won't forgive you of your sins. Amen? Mm-hmm. And do not lead us into temptation, because God is not a tempter of evil, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. By prayer, we insist that God's will is greater than our own. I'm going to get to you, Sister Erica. By prayer, we insist that God's will is greater than our own. The very nature of prayer is a humble place. And see, Let me show you how contrary it is to the world. The world teach you. We raise it. Come on, I'm even like that. I raise my daughter so that she won't have to ask for nothing. We raise, you shouldn't, we try to sculpture or fashion ourselves to where we won't be codependent on nobody but ourselves. That's contrary to scripture. The scripture wants us to be fully dependent upon God. Fully. So in prayer, the nature of prayer is asking for something you don't have. So by prayer, we insist that God's will is greater than our own and that we need God's help to perform or carry out his agenda. Amen. One of the greatest temptations there is to pursue your own will. That's one of the greatest temptations. We got to fight that every day. This is why he said your will be, it's part of his example of how to pray is your will be done. Your kingdom come, your will be done, not mine. Right? That's why we continue. That's why the Bible says pray without ceasing. Because I might have got through the day fine, but guess what? I need to pray tomorrow when I wake up and through tomorrow that tomorrow I do the same thing. That I continue to follow or walk in the things of God. Because even though we're a spirit, we still have flesh, and the flesh wants what it wants. We haven't been fully changed yet. Amen? So it's still that process. The work that he's begun in us, he shall continue. So we want to be workers with God in that, helping him continue this work that he has begun in us through prayer and continuous repentance. We should repent every day. Every day you should repent. If you ain't repenting every day, that's because you think you don't have sin. If you don't repent every day, you ain't humble. You think at some point in time, I've arrived to a certain level where I ain't got to repent. That's a lie. The Bible says if a man says he's without sin, he calls God a lie. And the Bible says let God be true and every man a liar. Amen? Here's another great example of how prayer is the gateway of staying in God's perfect will. Luke 22:39-43. And again, this is another moment where Jesus is the example. Amen. Luke 22:39. And I like this passage as well, because it just displays God in his earthly state. He's all God and all man at the same time. Amen. So this is the moment when he's at the Garden of Gethsemane. Luke 22:39. We're going to read through 43. Coming out, he went to the Mount of Olives as he was accustomed. And his disciples also followed him. So look at this. The disciples, they followed Christ, but this following wasn't just them following him, and we're going to see this. Jesus Christ had them follow him so that they can watch him. And we're going to see this in this moment, right? When he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. Now, this could be our actual principle, which it is, because this is why we pray. We pray that every day so that we can stay in God's perfect will. But I believe the temptation was so that they won't fall asleep. And we're going to see this, because God wanted them to be up and attentive watching Christ. He wanted to exemplify something to them. He wanted them to see him pray. He wanted them to see him in weakness and how he dealt with weakness. And humbleness. He wanted them to see this, right? So when he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if it is your will, take this cup from me. Some translations say, bitter cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. So look at this. We must believe, the Bible says that we must, to come to God and pray first, we must believe that he is. and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So here it is, we see an immediate response from God from Christ's prayer. Christ is weak. In some translations, it even talked about that he was sweating blood. Getting close to the passion moment, right? Getting close to the moment where he took on the cross. This was a heavy moment for Christ in his humanity. He was all God and all man at the same time. And one other reason why he came was to exemplify how we should walk. This is why he told them, pray so that you won't enter into temptation. Amen. As Christians, we must understand where our help comes from. Our help comes from God. Christ, he exemplified that. Jesus Christ depended on God the Father to carry out his will. He never operated in and of himself, even though he could have, because he was God too. But he showed us humility in his walk on earth, in that everything he do, he depended fully on the Father. And it further shows that he wanted them to watch him, because he came back and they said what? When Jesus Christ came back to the spot they was, what they was doing? They were asleep. So what did Christ do? He woke them up and he said, listen, stay up and watch me. Went back again and did the same thing, came back what they was doing. Sleep. Sleeping is good in the flesh. We need our rest. I need to give me some sleep medicine now. But when it comes to the things of God, we must put the flesh under subjection. Because it was a bigger point to be made right there. God wanted them to see. Christ wanted them to see how to deal with dilemmas, how to deal with temptation, how to deal with giants, how to deal with life's problems, how to deal with trouble. The Bible says in this world you will have tribulations, but be of good cheer. Amen. As Christians, we must understand where our help comes from. Amen. We must understand that we need help, and we must understand why help comes from. Amen. Philippians 2:13. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. It's God. So we must stay in contact with God to perform what is good. It's him who doing it. It's him who did it through Christ. At that moment, he said God sent angels to strengthen him. At that moment, Christ was strengthened in his spirit. Amen. So we pray for spiritual strength to face what we're facing in the natural. But the Bible says we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, rulers of darkness. Right? So what we see in the physical isn't the problem. So we must go back to the spiritual to get strength to handle what we see in the physical. This is why we pray. And we to make sure that we handle it in the right way. Because we can find ourselves fighting in the physical, but the only thing that's happening is we're getting tired and tired and tired. Tired and tired and tired. More woe down and woe down. And people constantly encouraging you to fight that way. No. I need to go to the spiritual, hand it over to him. The Bible says, cast your cares upon me. Amen. Then I come back and I stand steadfast. I stand steadfast. That's all God called us to do. I go get strength in the physical and I come back and I stand steadfast in the word. Amen. Then Christ, God, will fight through you. Because God wants us to be content. See, we want the problems to end. God wants the problems to last a little longer, because the problems is testing you. It's building you.
Not even the flesh, but the spirit.
The spirit is building you in the spirit. It's hurting you in the flesh, but it's building you in the spirit. Amen? Because the things that hurt are often the things that build character. Amen? It is God who works in you. Somebody say, it's God who works in me. Both to will and to do. It's none of us. It's just us being humble enough to place ourselves in a position where God can use us. Amen. We want to be the one to do. We want to be the one revealed as a mighty man of God. But you being a mighty man of God, or you being a mighty vessel of God, depending on you making yourself available to him. But we want to be seen as that. And we want many people who just want to be seen as a mighty man. Ooh, that man's so mighty. No, he ain't. God is mighty. God is mighty and working through this man. Sometimes we thank God working through people, but we ain't. We just see the man.